Again, we are continuing to tackle the issue that we have started several weeks ago, our manners with Allah, good manners towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today we are going to focus on taking positions. When Allah takes a position and we decide to take a different position, that definitely is not good manners. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a very clear position that there are such a thing as enemies to Allah and enemies to His Prophet and enemies to you. And when you read the Quran, very powerful. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا عَدُوِّي وَعَدُوَّكُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ Oh, you who believe, do not take my enemies and your enemies as the closest supporters and allies. Don't take them for confident. Don't rely on them. Don't confide to them. Don't give them the secrets and the information about what you're doing, where you are, what you think, because they will abuse it. They will hurt you. If you read the rest of the ayah, it goes on to say that you are reaching out to them with innocent love, powerful love, intense love. تلقون إليهم بالمودة وأنا أعلم بما أعلنتم وما أسررتم. And I know what you declare in public and what you keep in private. Amazing. Allah is telling us He knows how we think, what our motives are, why do we take certain positions towards certain people. And the next part is what is most amazing. He says, يُخْرِجُونَ الرَّسُولَ وَإِيَّاكُمْ They kick the Prophet ﷺ and you out of your own homeland. يُخْرِجُونَ الرَّسُولَ وَإِيَّاكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ خَرَجْتُمْ جِهَادًا فِي سَبِيلِي وَابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِي As if Allah is telling us very clearly that He took them for His enemies based on their position towards you, towards the Prophet, towards the message. So we have to be very careful that we do not take the enemies of Allah. And how do we know these enemies? The ayah says, يُخْرِجُونَ الرَّسُولَ وَإِيَّاكُمْ Those who are fighting the message of Allah, fighting the Prophet, fighting the message of Islam. And they can go and are going as far as kicking you out of your homeland. That is a position. You want to call it political position? Allah doesn't call it that. When it comes to your safety, when it comes to your interest, Allah is the one who guarantees your protection. إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Your actual protector. And the closest to you is always going to be Allah, His messenger, and the believers. So the ayat in this thread under that theme are so extensive in the Quran that it leaves no room for anyone to know who is the enemy of Allah and then take them for friends. Especially when we know that Allah only takes a position against a person based on one of two things. Either declared position towards Allah, if the person declares Allah as his enemies, then he positioned himself as the enemy of Allah. If the person puts himself or herself as an enemy to the messenger, an enemy to Islam, an enemy to the Muslims, then Allah takes him for the enemy he is. Now, our enemies are two levels or two kinds, but they are all one and the same in nature. It is those who go in extreme opposition to Allah and disobedience and rebellion against Allah, but we never take anybody enemy for their animosity of Allah. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't take my enemy and your enemy. So if he qualifies for the two, then he becomes your enemy because he wants to get you down. He wants to finish you off. Then he becomes definitely, as he declares himself as your enemy, then he becomes your enemy. The Quran is a very beautiful book, very logical book, very articulate. It is the word of Allah. How could it not be? So we have to study and read the Quran before we take positions for or against anyone. Now, some people take the enemies of his Muslim brothers and sisters as loyal, intimate, close protectors because of personal interest. That amounts to hypocrisy and nifaq. Because this person, if he goes to the enemies and divulges to them what shouldn't be known, then he positions himself as an enemy to the Muslims. But because he comes and declares himself as a Muslim, then you treat him as a Muslim. But if he does the two, then he is a hypocrite. He is showing us what he is hiding from us, and he is giving them what they ask of him. And unfortunately, those days and since 9/11, there is a lot of enemies within the community that are working to break down the confidence and the lines and the rows of our community. And we have to be extremely careful that we do not let our children in particular become victims and easy prey for their aggressive tactics. It has been announced before by our government that they are after Muslims as they claim they are sleeping cells, they are hiding this, they are lone wolves, and all of those terms just to discredit your confidence in your deen and your willingness to stand up for your faith. Allah says, stand up for your faith no matter what. As much as you stand for justice, you stand for your interest. Because if you don't protect your interest, nobody else will. But there is another dangerous type of enemy that Allah also declared to us from the beginning of creation. As much as we spend time tracking the tactics of human enemies, we have to also know the tactics of shaitan. Inna shaitana lakum aduw, fattakhidhuhu aduwa. Your position towards the shaitan should be as if you are dealing with a person. Some of us treat the shaitan casually because we don't see them. But you will never see the shaitan, but you will see his tactics. You will see his ways. And he declared this in the Quran. Allah recorded his tactics. فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. By your honor and glory, I will most certainly deceive all of them. I will tempt all of them. إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. Except those servants of yours who are righteous and pious. So even the shaitan, when he asked for a license from Allah to tempt us, he knew his limits. He has limits. So if you are really righteous, the shaitan will have no access, no power to do anything. Allah answered him and said, "Inna ibadi laysa laka alayhim sultan." You have no power of temptation, of persuasion when it comes to my servants. Inna ibadi. And remember, the shaitan said, "Illa ibadaka minhum al-mukhlasin," except your sincerest of servants. Allah says, my servants in general, you have no power over them. Then where does the shaitan get his power? If Allah tells him you have no power, if he vows that he will only tempt those who are not righteous, right? Then where does he get the power over those who are seemingly righteous? It is when you give him the power of your obedience, the power over your ears and your eyes and your heart, then that power he grabs and he tempts you. And he tells us, وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي. I had no power over you except that I called you and you responded to me. So Allah calls us, our families call us, our self calls us every day, and our friends call us for things, right? لَهُ أَصْحَابٌ يَدْعُونَهُ إِلَى الْهُدَىٰ أَتِنَا. Everything in this life calls you for something. So there are so many competing calls and invitations and parties to attend. Which one do you choose? It is based on what is truly important in your heart. If what is important in your heart is Allah, then His calls get the first response. It takes the first priority. Because Allah taught us that He is Akbar. He is greater than all. So if we treat Him as such, which means we become people with good manners, when you get two calls, one of them always will get your priority. So if you put Allah second, never expect Him to put you first. And remember, as you ask Allah for things, there are billions of other people asking Him, maybe for one and the same thing. So do you think He will answer the ones who do not respond to Him and give them what they ask and not answer the ones who respond to Him? It doesn't make sense. So Allah says, "Ud'uni astajib lakum." Pray to me, ask me, and I will answer you, I will respond to you. That's the Quran. But in the Hadith Qudsi, Allah says, "Muru bil ma'roof, wanhaw 'anil munkar qabla an tad'uni fala astajib lakum." So there is a condition for responding to Him, and there is a situation when He will not respond to us. We have to respond to Him first. He created us. His actions started first. He created us. He provided us with hearing, the sight, and the heart, and the hands, and everything else. And even before we existed, He created the whole world for us and made everything soft and handy and available for us even before we existed. Now that He gave us the earthly facility to use temporarily until we meet Him, then we end up abusing what He gave and ask for what He didn't yet. It doesn't make sense. So part of our good manners with Allah is the good use of what He has already provided, to make sense with ourselves and to be consistent and harmonious with our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to accept the responsibility of being servants. He is the master, Allah, and we are His servants. Not that He needs our service, but that we need His mercy. We need His acceptance. We need His care. And we pray and cry for it when we need it badly. It is readily available. It is readily available. وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. What more do you ask than the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What more? He says, رَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. My mercy covered everything. It encompassed everything. فَسَأَكْتُبُهَا لِلَّذِينَ يَتَّقُونَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. I will prescribe it for those who establish prayer. And as I always mention, the term أَقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ is reference to إِقَامَةُ الدِّينِ as a whole. Because the salah is the most regular religious ritual that we have committed to when we said لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. So Allah, to highlight the religion, He uses prayer. أَقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ. So we have to be careful that our relationship with Allah is not one-sided, that He created, He punishes, he gives as if it is all at random. No. Nothing is random. In this universe, nothing is random. Not your creation, not your provision, not your death, not your family. Nothing is random. Everything is by due specific measure. إِنَّا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ بِقَدَرٍ. Everything is created in due measure. So we have to treat Allah with the glory to His majesty that is deserving of His greatness in our heart. Allah tells us that those who don't believe in Him, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ, they have not appreciated Allah the way He ought to be appreciated. They were not polite. They didn't have good manners. Because you ask them, who created you? They say Allah. Who created heavens and earth? They say Allah. Who provides for you? They say Allah. Then the Quran raises a rhetorical question. قُلْ فَأَنَّا تُؤْفَكُونَ. Where do you come up with those fabrications? Worshipping yourself, worshipping your boss, worshipping your money, worshipping a stone. Where do you come with this from? Where is your good sense and good manners? That, when absent, it can lead directly to kufr. When our good manners are left behind, it can lead us to complete kufr. Because there are two levels of kufr. There is the denial of Allah's existence and presence and control over this life. And there is the denial of the fact that He is a giver. To deny His gift by not offering gratitude or not remembering Allah. وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. The munafiqeen, the hypocrites, only remember Allah or mention Allah very scarcely. Very sporadically, only when they need it, only when they want to prove that they are still belonging to Islam and they still believe in the faith and so on. But other than that, they don't remember and they don't want to remember. So the difference between the Muslim and the hypocrite is that the Muslim remembers Allah a lot. وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ. Those who remember Allah a lot, males or females, so that our faith is not to be taken as a male-centered religion. Allah mentions, مَنْ عَمِلَ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ. هُوَ includes هُوَ and هِيَ. This is the Arabic language. So it's preceded by مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى, male or female, فَسَنُدْخِلَنَّهُ جَنَّات, they will enter into paradise, staying there forever, خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا. So we have to be careful that we should position ourselves where Allah is. There is an issue of testimony or judgment or anything that people dispute. You need to know where does Allah stand on the issue before you speak. But when you speak, don't say that is the position of Allah. Because it is your connection between the facts of the issue and the text that you are relying on. So don't say this is Allah's rule. Say this is my judgment. This is my understanding. So that you are humble. And that's part of being with good manners, that you are humble. You refer to Allah and defer to Allah, that you always have a reference. What is your reference? La ilaha illallah. What is your source? Al-Quran. When it is not in the Quran, what's your source? The Sunnah, the Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have to understand that this enemy, which we call the Shaytan, that we blame so much for our choices and our decisions and our taste and our mizaj and hawa and whims and desires, he does not fabricate our desires. He latches to them. He knows what you want. You love money. He's going to play with you on the money issue. you love women, he's going to play with you on that issue. Whatever you love, this is what he latches to tempt you or to persuade you to violate your own ethics. Okay? You love your business, that is where he latches to. The shaitan says, وَلَأُضِلَّنَّهُمْ I will lead them astray. وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ And I will make them live based on just wishful thinking. Keep wishing. When this happens, I will do this. When this happens, I will make tawbah. When this happens, I will be good. When this happens, I will start praying. All of this is wishful thinking. Where does it come from? The Quran is clear. It is following the shaitan. It is following the shaitan. وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ وَلَآمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُبَتِّكُنَّ آذَانَ الْأَنْعَامِ I will command them so that they are so harsh, even with the animals, cutting their ears. What benefit does a man have cutting the ears of the animal? لَيُبَتِّكُنَّ آذَانَ الْأَنْعَامِ وَلَآمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ And I will command them so that they change the creation of Allah. Changing the creation has always been misread to talk about physical change of the creation of Allah. But if you read the Quran, you know that it is much deeper than that. You change the creation of Allah when you change His principles to your principle. When you want to go in a different direction and claim that you are going towards Allah, when you know you are not. When you choose a God to worship other than Allah, but then claim that you are worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That changes the nature of creation, even if it doesn't change the physical creation. There is little we can do, actually, to change anything in the physical creation. There is little we could do. Over the ages, very little man has done. No matter how great in our eyes it may be, but it's very little compared to the greatness of this vast creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So changing the creation of Allah is by changing His rules, by adapting rules other than His, by following gods other than Him, by following guidance other than the one He had sent down, by discounting the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for any other message, by giving priority to anyone other than Allah. And you read the following ayah, it will give you that clarity of understanding. It says, وَمَنْ يَتَّخِذِ الشَّيْطَانَ وَلِيًّا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُبِينًا Anyone who takes shaitan as his closest loyal supporter, the one who gives, who is given his obedience, his commitment, his listening, his ears, his eyes, his everything, then he has lost everything. فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُبِينًا So, clearly in the Quran, everything that relates to your fate at the end of the day is actually in your hand. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Yasin, which many of us memorize, أَلَمْ أَعْهَدْ إِلَيْكُمْ يَا بَنِي آدَمَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ الشَّيْطَانِ Haven't I taken your covenant, O children of Adam, that you never worship or give worship and obedience and commitment to the shaitan? إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ Since he is to you a clear enemy. وَأَنِعْبُدُونِي And part of the covenant that you worship me. هَذَا صِرَاطٌ مُسْتَقِيمٌ This is a straight path. So very clearly Allah wants us to make a choice. Make a choice. Don't let this issue float. Someday I am with the shaitan because I am this and I am that. All reasons come, right? False reasons. And then some other day, because I need Allah, I am desperate, or I am sick, or I need something, I go all the way to Allah and try to forget about the shaitan. As soon as Allah gives me what I ask for, I forget Allah. This floating is not good because you don't know the minute when you leave this world. Is it going to be a minute of obedience or a minute of obedience to the shaitan? So we have to make a strategic position that is consistent with good manners with Allah, with all what He has given us. It doesn't just make any sense that particularly His enemies become our closest allies and supporters and confidants. It doesn't make sense. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our hearts to take Him for who He is, in His glory, in His majesty, and to give us the strength to be committed only to Him and to forget all else. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا مولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد, good manners with Allah are things that you develop of how you relate to Allah, how you connect with Allah, how you think of Allah. What do you think of Allah? So some people think of Allah the worst. وَظَنَنْتُمْ ظَنَّ السَّوْءِ. And you thought the worst of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah cleared that for you. So we have to be careful that even in the darkest of dark times, that you always keep your head and hands up asking Allah, and asking Him with confidence and trust that Allah, إِنَّ رَبِّي سَمِيعٌ قَرِيبٌ. Allah always hears and He's too close, He's too near. So I shouldn't think of Him as someone far. A Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Kaaba and he asked him, is Allah too close so I should whisper when I talk to Him? Or is He too far so I need to yell out to Him? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the ayah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبُ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. What is the condition? فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. Very simple. If and when my servants ask you regarding me, I am near. He didn't even say, tell them I am near. He didn't put Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the middle. He talked to us directly. فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ. I respond to the call of the caller. إِذَا دَعَانِ. If. So those who do not pray to Allah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. Those who are too arrogant to pray to Allah, too arrogant to ask Allah, or too hopeless to ask Allah, they will get into Jahannam. Look at this. You are either His best friend and most loyal servant, or you are His enemy. Take a position. But then there is a condition. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. Let them respond to me. وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. And let them believe in me. Let them trust me. Let them have faith in me. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. So that they may reach the degree of maturity. To act like mature people. Because the essence of how we actually deal with Allah is that we are dealing with Allah with the child's mind in our head. We're not treating Allah like mature grown-up people. What is the difference? Children only come to their parents when they need something, right? But even when their parents call, right, they are reluctant to answer lest they will ask them to do something, right? And Allah says, no, you have to respond to me for me to respond to you. An adult would understand this condition, but a child would say, oh no, I will only pray when I need Him. And then some people go around and tell their friends that they know they are committed, they are praying, they are seemingly pious, and they tell them, pray to Allah to guide me. Come on, he already did. He told you what to do to be guided, right? Why don't you do it and you pray to him? No, we are like children. Talk to the teacher to give me better grades. It doesn't make sense. You have to do your homework. So we have to change the attitude of laxity, taking Allah for granted, because he said, إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, right? And we want to erase the part where he says, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَشَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Your Lord is very severe when it comes to punishment. And when someone tells you that the penalty is too high, you take care, you pay attention. It is like if the penalty for violating a traffic light or speed limit is only $100, and you have the $100, you don't pay much attention, right? But if it is $500, that's quite some money, right? So it depends on how much you appreciate what Allah sets. So Allah sets penalties that are quite severe to deter us from venturing into His sanctuaries. Whatever is haram, we should never venture into that area. We should be clear and far away. So Allah wants us to treat Him with respect, with appreciation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to do that. Allahumma hadina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا، غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا دينا إلا قضيته، ولا كربا إلا نفسته، ولا هما إلا فرجته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا غائبا إلا رددته، ولا مظلوما إلا نصرته، ولا مجاهدا إلا أيدته ونصرته. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان، اللهم انصر المستضعفين في كل مكان. اللهم عليك بالظالمين والجبارين، اللهم عليك بالظالمين والجبارين، فإنهم لا يعجزونك. اللهم انزع سلطان الطغاة عن بلاد المسلمين، اللهم انزع سلطان الطغاة عن بلاد المسلمين، اللهم انزع سلطان الطغاة عن بلاد المسلمين. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، وأعلي بفضلك يا رب كلمتي الحق والدين. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.